Hello, everyone, and welcome to Art 100, Looking at Art. I'm Bernard Baker, Professor of Art at California State University, Dominguez Hills. And today we are going to be talking totally about the Renaissance. The Renaissance, tremendous period in art, actually a major pivotal point in art from what it had been to what it now becomes. It's like the doorway to modern art as it opens up into a whole new view of what art is all about. But before we go to that, let me just remind you, here we are 1 week before Thanksgiving, and we need to be concerned about how things are going to be wrapped up, because they are going to be wrapped up, whether we like it or not. The ArtSight paper is due on November 30th. I forgot what day of the week that is. I think that's a Tuesday, but I'm not really sure. Anyway, it has to be postmarked that day, excuse me, or delivered to the art department that day. I know some of you are close enough that you can deliver the paper by hand, but others of you will need to mail it in, so you can have it postmarked that day, or you can have it delivered by hand that day. So it has to be in that day, otherwise the grade of the paper will be depreciated for every day that it's late. So make sure you get that taken care of. There were some concerns about thank you. It is a Tuesday. I was right about that. I just had little birds come in and tell me that. There is a concern on the part of some students as to what a theme binder is. I mentioned a theme binder. Your paper must be bound. If your paper is loose, I will not grade it. It will be given an F, and that will be it. It has to be bound in a theme binder. There are different kinds of theme binders. Now, I go through a demo for you. I mentioned this before. It's also posted up on Blackboard in the preface to the ArtSight paper. I go through a demo that is up on YouTube explaining not only what a theme binder is, but how to do the paper step by step. And the staff here was kind enough to set that up for me and let me do that and put it up on YouTube just for you. So you need to go to that website if you have any questions and look at that YouTube's demo and see if that answers your question. By the way, the web address for that YouTube site is in the preface to the ArtSight paper up on Blackboard. So check that out. And if you have questions, of course, let me know. Get in touch with me, and I'll try and answer those questions. All right. So that's the ArtSight paper. Those of you that are doing some extra credit, that has to be in, I think, by the 7th. Let me just check on that. I forget if that's the 7th or the 14th. Let me just check, because I'm pretty sure that extra credit has to be in by the 7th, right? Pearl Harbor Day, anniversary for Pearl Harbor. So make sure you attend to that. Again, if it's not in, by the way, our extra credit, I don't depreciate. I just simply don't accept them if they're not in on the 7th. So you need to get it in on the 7th, either postmarked or hand delivered on the 7th, okay? All right, that takes care of that. Bit of information. Let's get into the Renaissance. This is chapter 16 of our text. Basically, the Renaissance takes place from about 1400 to about 1420, 1450. A little bit of a transition on both ends, of course. It takes place in all these periods. So, for about 100 years, the Renaissance is going on 100, 125 years. As I mentioned, it's a major, major turning point in art. A lot of things happen. You already know about a lot of the things that happen. I'm sure in the history classes you had in high school and even here at the university, you've been told about all the discoveries, Cortez and Columbus and Diego and
all these people that were discovering parts of the world, all of the exploration, that took place during the Renaissance. Well, not only that, of course, but art was taking place. And I have a question for you. Actually, I have an answer for you. See if you can put some questions to this answer. The answer is the birth of Venus. The birth of Venus. What is the question? The birth of Venus. And this particular answer is relevant not only today, but also later on as we get close to the end of the semester. So all of these questions of the day are going to somehow pop up a little later on. So call me, 1-800-339-1193, or do as most of you do, text in and let me know a question about the birth of Venus. Okay? Let's see if we can, you can show me something about that. Okay. Now, let's take a look at where the Renaissance took place, because it actually started in Italy, but expanded throughout Italy to the rest of Europe. So let's get that map up, and a map of Europe, and we'll take a quick look at what that's all about here so you can get an idea. Let me just get that full screen, and I'll show you kind of what's taking place here. Naturally, in Italy, this is the Mediterranean, of course, all in through here. I'm reading a good book about the Mediterranean right now, as a matter of fact. Here's Italy, the boot, of course, and Italy is where we've seen a lot of art begin to emerge. And, of course, the Romans were here, and they left a lot of ruins. The Greeks were over in here. They left a lot of ruins. And as a result of that, the Renaissance started here in Italy and spread north up into what's called the Netherlands, up in here, and then eventually over into Germany, into France, and up into England. And ultimately began to affect all of Europe, even down into Spain. So that's what happened with the Renaissance. And, of course, the characteristics of the Renaissance, that is what brought the Renaissance about and what were the consequences. Well, the Renaissance essentially brought cultural and aesthetic changes in art and architecture throughout Europe. It began in Italy, however. So some of the things you need to be aware of, and this is well documented in our text, one is there was a renewed interest in classical Greek and Roman art and architecture. Now, this is the second time we've seen this happen. The Renaissance is the second time. Remember we talked about the Romanesque architecture that took place in the 1100s, 11th and 12th centuries, with the thick churches that were built with the Roman arches. That was the first influence that reoccurred from what's called classical art, primarily in this case Roman work. Now the Renaissance has come along and there's been a renewed interest in this source of tremendous art and architecture. Second, there was a pursuit of knowledge and discovery and a belief that mankind had worth in the eyes of God. Throughout the Middle Ages that we're coming from, that was not the case. Mankind was not involved in knowledge. It was basically survival. Knowledge and learning were not pursuits that had the motivation to be pursued. So as a consequence, there was very little in terms of discoveries and expansion, at least notable. There were things that happened, but it wasn't until the Renaissance when there was a renewed interest in this. And obviously, spiritually, there was a turning of the attitude of the church and the people in regard to the position and the relevance of mankind in regard to how God looked upon mankind. And that's significant because spiritualism was a major force coming out of the medieval times. All of this 500 years or so from the Romans up until, actually it was longer than that. We're talking about, you know, almost, 500, 600 years up until the Renaissance. So that was a major shift as well. That's number two. Number three is artists became interested in the natural world. that as they're moving away from all the works that are primarily spiritual oriented, they're now looking at the world, looking at landscapes and natural things. They became interested in the effects of light, which, of course, there's one term for that is chiaroscuro, which is the effect of light and dark, shadows and highlight kind of effect, spotlight kind of effect. And linear and atmospheric perspective were developed, understood and developed during this time. So that was a major breakthrough. And, of course, a major aspect that we've learned now from our chapter on painting, oil paint came into being. This before this, they were painting with encaustic and tempera and other media that were less permanent and not as malleable as we see oil paint to be. Those are some of the major aesthetic qualities that took place. Then, fourth, the nude figure came back into prominence, recognized for its beauty and recognized for harmonious proportions in artwork. So we see a reemergence of the nude figure. Now, when did we last see that? Back in the Greek and Roman, particularly the Greek period. The Romans to some extent, but the Greeks, I mean, they idolized and saw the ideal human as the young male nude, if you remember. Athletic, idealized, naturalistic male. The kuros, remember the term kuros? That's that came from the Greek idealization of that figure. And fifth, artists sought idealized beauty and harmonious proportions in artwork. Also, artists, I might go back to the news, artists began to study anatomy. I mean, there's stories of Michelangelo and I think Da Vinci actually dissecting corpse. They would have corpse dug up out of, illegally of course, dug up out of graves and dissect them in order to understand muscular structure and the skeletal structure and how the body worked. And also great artists became renowned and obtained a status of respectability during this period. Now before this, we haven't seen much of artists. We don't know many of the names. But now artists are beginning to emerge and being recognized. And lastly, rich merchants, rulers of Italy and the Netherlands became patrons of the arts, along with the nobility and the clergy. Before this time, it was primarily the church that sponsored artwork. But now we have this new economic environment that is giving rise to a new rich merchant class. And they began to be interested in art. So these are some of the reasons and the consequences of the Renaissance coming into being. And we have a comment here from Philip. Philip says, in a question of which the answer is the birth of Venus. That's the answer. He says, what is a painting where Renaissance artists turn to stories of Greek and Roman gods and goddesses? What is a painting done by Botticelli? Well, Philip's on to something here. Let's see what Wendy has to say. He says, Sandro Botticelli did the birth of Venus. It is a tempera on canvas. We should put that in question form, shouldn't we? What is the painting of birth of Venus done by Sandro Botticelli that is a tempera on canvas where Venus is the goddess of love and beauty? It's a question. And Wendy, you're right there with Philip. I can see the two of you must be collaborating. And what does Elizabeth have to say? She says, which statement best describes the imagery of the birth of Venus by Botticelli? Well, that answer of birth of Venus is not necessarily the answer to that, Elizabeth, but I love your question. I mean, the question is, what statement best describes the imagery of the birth of Venus by Botticelli? I suppose we could say that's the... I mean, you kind of give the answer in the question, don't you? So, but that's good. Okay. Roman God, what is the painting done by Botticelli? Was that someone else? Maybe not. Okay. You guys have buried that one. Let's take a look at this painting. This is the painting, Birth of Venus. And it's done by Sandro Botticelli. When was that done? That was done, as you know, when that was done. That was done in 1840. But I got those numbers backwards, 1480. Make sure we get the right century here. And do we have that painting? Yeah, there it is. There it is. It's up on my screen. There it is behind me. The birth of Venus. This is a tempera painting. This is before at least Botticelli began to use oil paint. But notice here we have a nude. She's centered. This piece is basically kind of symmetrical. We have two figures on either side. It's rather flat. We don't have a lot of good depth in the background. So we have primarily this foreground here. There's a lot of activity over here in this figure's, mythological figures here, and a figure on this side, another mythological figure with the birth of Venus on her shell in the center. And what does the author have to say about this piece? Venus was the... it goes on to say that one of the consequences of the artists in this time is they began to use mythology from the classical periods. So you can see this turning from Christian spiritual themes to now reaching back into mythology. We'll see more of this as it begins to come forth. One of the families that sponsored this was the Medici. The Medici family was a major family. I think they lived in Florence or Venice. I can't remember. They're in Florence. It says right here in the book. They're in Florence. And they sponsored a lot of artists. And they really kind of had a compound where they allowed artists to flourish. They would bring them in and house them and maintain upkeep for them and let them work. Botticelli, I think, was one of those. I think either Michelangelo or Da Vinci was a member of that process. A number of famous artists came out of the Medici kind of mass works there in terms of promoting artists. So they were prime promoters of artists themselves, the Medici. And I think they were the ones who sponsored, or at least had a lot to do with this piece of artwork. And it says here, the Venus was a Roman goddess of love and beauty. According to the legend, she was born from the sea. And so Botticelli depicts her on a floating shell. The wind god Zephyr and his wife blew her gently toward the shore, where a figure representing spring awaits, ready to clothe Venus in a flowing garment. And Botticelli paints the goddess in the nude with strategically placed hands and a tress of nude hair, the only concession to modesty. Such a large-scale depiction of the female nude in art is virtually unknown. So we see how this has come back again. So it's a great painting, and it shows how the artists were very interested in classical times. Okay, I'm going to have another question for you here in a second, but let's talk a little bit about show some pieces of early Renaissance painting, The Lamentation by Giotto, and this begins to show how the artists were beginning to deal with figures in a more realistic setting, beginning to show movement, involvement, kind of human activity, moving away from the rigid kind of art that was prominent before that. One more piece, the Christ entering Jerusalem by Duccio. This is a piece that shows the humble beginnings, the humble use of isometric perspective. You see here the isometric perspective in this wall where the lines remain parallel. Up here, we see the lines remain parallel in this building as the artist is trying to depict depth in this piece. And you see how it's rather awkward, the perspective in this area as opposed to this area, as opposed to what's happening up in here. We get kind of like three different perspectives going on. And last, let me show you The Birth of the Virgin by Lorenzetti. This is a piece that, again, that shows a little bit more confidence in terms of one-point perspective. We see that taking place back here in the back. But then rather flat images of the figures in here done reminiscent of what we saw coming out of the
the Romanesque and the Gothic era, but yet a sense of a little bit more humanistic qualities. We have a person leaning, which is kind of a model for the reclining nudes we'll see in the future. We have people down here busy with kind of homespun activities, and people over here talking a little bit more casual, as we see here as well. So some of the human endeavors are starting to be taking place here. Now, I have a video clip I want to show you here. This is Siena and Florence, two major centers of art in the early Renaissance, which features Lorenzetti and Giotto, two famous artists. You're going to hear all these names of artists now, these Italian artists that are emerging. So just take a look at this for a few minutes and get a sense of what happened in the early Renaissance.
A wonderfully preserved medieval city in central Italy. At its heyday around 1300, it was one of the most civilized and prosperous places in Europe. Siena and the other Italian city-states of its time, like Florence, can stand as a new beginning in our story of Western art. Hitherto, the old medieval worldview had, put simply, divided the classes of society into the aristocracy at the top, the church, and the laboring peasantry at the bottom. But in places like this, we see for the first time in European history a new class, conscious of its own identity, the merchants. These cities were no longer controlled by feudal lords. They were republics. Here in Siena, several thousand citizens were eligible for election to the governing bodies, which met down there in the Palazzo Pubblico. And in the palazzo, there is a fresco painted in the 1340s, which encapsulates their faith in the secular arts government, in the moderating power of reason in human society. It's called the Effects of Good Government. This marvelous fresco, painted by Ambrogio Lorenzetti, was the first panoramic landscape on this scale in Western art. The peasants bringing their produce from the countryside, the merchants going about their business, the elegant ladies of leisure, all are fused into an idealized image of the well-governed city-state. Years later, the Black Death devastated Siena. It killed the artist Lorenzetti and half the population of Europe. It was the greatest catastrophe in the modern history of the West, but surprisingly, for some regions, the plague was a springboard for economic growth. For the survivors, there were new opportunities. Florence recovered particularly quickly. By 1400, this was the city-state that dominated central Italy. The bankers and textile merchants were expanding their trading empires all over Europe. Over the next 100 years, an extraordinary interaction took place in Florence. The innovations of artists and architects, the excitement of rediscovering classical achievements, and the patronage of a wealthy commercial class. These key elements brought about a series of artistic and intellectual breakthroughs that came to be known as the Renaissance, literally the rebirth of learning and culture. In the Church of Santa Croce, a series of frescoes painted around 1320 were to have a revolutionary effect on Florentine painting. Here, the great merchant families competed with one another to commission the leading artists to decorate their chapels. In the chapel of the Bardi family, Professor John White of University College London describes how these medieval images came to life.
This is a Franciscan church, and the Franciscans were the passionate preachers of the late medieval world. They used their words to target the emotions of the faithful, rich and poor alike. And at the same time, the painters increasingly tried to bring the Gospels and the stories of the saints to life before their very eyes. At first, as you can see in this late 13th century St. Francis altarpiece, they did it with stiff, imposing figures and with bright, doll-like, symbolic scenes and images. And here next door, in a much ruined fresco, I'm afraid, maybe probably only 30 or 40 years later, you can see the revolution represented by the art of Giotto, the great contemporary of the poet Dante. Here is a new, soft, warm reality, a new humanity and pathos, a new ability to keep the faithful back, make them feel that they are actually there and filled with love for this loving saint whose love of Christ and love of life and of the beauties of the world were a transformation in the spiritual life of the earth.
Giotto's frescoes gave a new sense of weight to the human body, a new sense of urgency in narrative painting. They became an academy for later Italian artists. Raphael and Michelangelo came here to learn from such dramatic images as this, in which St. Francis receives the wounds of Christ over his hands and feet.
You can see how the beginnings of the Renaissance began to take place as a result of merging out of the tragedies and the oppression and the depression of the Middle Ages. I mean, it's like a prime time, and as the countries began to consolidate and to find means of communication, means of transportation, means of commerce, there began to be this opening that allowed all of the new ideas to flow. People began to feel more comfortable. And this opened up the early Renaissance, 1400 to 1500 approximately. This is the development and emergence of the Renaissance characteristics. And these are essentially the use of oil paint, use of strips, canvas, and easels. This is a major breakthrough. I mean, before this, the artists were painting on walls, painting on wood. Basically, those were the surfaces that they had. And they were restricted to the architecture that they were working on, or in terms of the sponsors, they were restricted to spiritual themes for the most part. And as I said, linear perspective was developed. This was a major breakthrough. If you remember our study of the camera arts, we saw the camera obscura, that device that allowed a pinhole camera that allowed a scene to be projected onto a dark wall within a room, and it would be upside down, but the artist could indeed see what a scene in our natural viewing would look like on a flat surface. Suddenly, they saw converging lines instead of parallel lines. In other words, they saw linear perspective instead of isometric perspective. Okay, major breakthrough. The influence of classical art, we already talked about that, of course. In Italy, there was all kinds of ruins around them. They had the Colosseum and the Pantheon and all the buildings of Rome and Pompeii. Well, I don't know if Pompeii wasn't. I don't think Pompeii was discovered then. I think it was still buried. And other ruins, however, throughout Italy, that gave them insight and clues to the art and architecture of the Romans. Not to mention, they just had to go across Adriatic Sea. I can't remember the one between Italy and Greece. I should know that, but someone will tell me. Anyway, go across there over to Greece, and they could see all the ruins in Greece. So, tremendous resource in terms of being influenced by classical art. And, of course, the interest in biblical and classical mythology, biblical scenes and stories, events and personalities, and classical mythology. These were combined. And also individual portraiture.
began to emerge much more because the artists were much more interested in that. And we saw that the ruling class and the rich merchants could afford this. And, of course, interest in learning, philosophy, nature, youth, the male figure, exploration, science, all of these things opened up the Renaissance. Now, I have another great video here for you that is, I may not show all of this to you, but I wanted to let you see the transformation. It's called The Transformation of Classical Culture, and it deals with craftsmen and artists. In other words, the craftsmen began to be formed into guilds, and artists began to emerge in terms of dealing with decoration and, of course, artistic endeavors. And this began to give more credence and acknowledgement and respect to the arts and crafts. So let's take a look at this so you get a chance to get a little bit better idea of how this early Renaissance was taking place.
But if the prosperity of Florence was owed to the bankers, the rebirth of its intellectual energy came from the rediscovery of classical culture.
Without ever leaving Santa Croce, we can move into the world of the Renaissance in this tomb of Leonardo Bruni, longtime Chancellor of Florence, who died in 1444. This was the Florence of humanists, the students of the classics, of the knowledge and the wisdom of the ancient world. They went right back to the origins of Western thought in the great Greek philosophers. He also wrote A History of Florence, starting with Roman times. And in this great work, he put historical writing also onto a new footing, both in terms of its literary content and its scholarly underpinning. And there he lies, his history on his breast, surrounded by a wealth of classical detail, his ear spotted by the Roman eagles, and his hope of heaven in the wrangle of the Virgin Child above his head. This monument in itself is a wordless combination. The Christian and the classical.
This is the Pantheon, the most perfectly preserved temple of ancient Rome. Scholars like Bruni and the artists of Renaissance Florence had a passionate love affair with antiquity. The humanists recovered and translated the texts, the artists studied the statues and the frescoes. But they were not simply copying the achievements of the ancient world, they were transforming them. This Renaissance design for an ideal city uses classical architecture to create a perfect environment based upon reason and order. And in perhaps the most famous image of man by a Renaissance artist, Leonardo da Vinci is illustrating the Roman author Vitruvius. Man, in his ideal proportions, is the measure of all things. Under their preoccupation with classical harmony and proportion, Renaissance artists created these new images of man and woman.
Inside the Palazzo Vecchio, the 5,000 or so Florentines had the right to vote. Meet, summoned by the bell in times of crisis. They were the members of the influential guilds and represented the craftsmen and the most economically important activities. Sculptors and stoneworkers, textiles, metal workers, masons and builders, lawyers and solicitors. The engine driving the art of Florence at the beginning of the 15th century was competition between the guilds and competition between the artists commissioned by them. The Armourers Guild paid for this powerful, alert image of their patron saint, St. George by Donatello. Roman art transformed into a vision of Christian courage. The Bankers Guild paid for Ghiberti's expensive bronze statue of St. Matthew, the patron saint of money changers. These reliefs are the two front runners for the most famous of all Florentine competitions, held in 1401 to decide the commission for new bronze doors for the baptistry. The subject is the prophet Abraham, about to sacrifice his son Isaac, and this entry by the young Brunelleschi emphasizes the violence of the act. Abraham holds Isaac by the throat to plunge the knife in. The angel seizes Abraham's wrist in a dramatic last-minute intervention. But Lorenzo Ghiberti won the competition with this relief, immediately acknowledged as an exhibition of unrivaled craftsmanship. The nude figure of Isaac is based on classical models. This is a triumph of the goldsmith's craft, embodying lessons learned from antique statuary and combining that with a Gothic grace learned from the art of Northern Europe. Florence is still a thriving center for goldsmith's art. This is the studio of Signor Giorgio Chileri at the south end of the Ponte Vecchio, and he was here as a master with his apprentice craftsmen. Our whole generation of famous Florentine artists, Ghiberti, Brunelleschi, Donatello, began work in studios not unlike this, working on just such meticulous and minute creations before moving on in their careers to their monumental work. In such an environment where the skill of the craftsman is so highly prized, it was inevitable, perhaps, that their status should rise. Inevitable, too, that the most brilliant of them, men like Brunelleschi and Donatello, should resent the restrictions which the craft guilds could place on them, and resent, too, the implication that somehow their work was menial, a mechanical craft. And so, increasingly during this century, such artists came to see themselves as the equals of their patrons, no longer humble, anonymous craftsmen, but self-confident, ambitious, intellectual practitioners of the liberal arts, things beyond their own city.
Okay, we're seeing how the Renaissance is developing. We're seeing particularly the competition for the bronze doors. The Ghiberti, who won the piece, Lorenzo Ghiberti. Let's take a look at that piece, The Sacrifice of Isaac. This is really considered sometimes to be, by many authorities, to be kind of the opening of the Renaissance. It really kind of culminates into saying, here is what the Renaissance is. This is a deep relief piece that is done for the competition of the brass, these huge doors, of which there would be many, many panels that would be designed and executed for this piece. And you can see that this is called a deep relief, meaning that the images are very much raised away from the surface, but it has a naturalistic stance here, yet individualized recognition of the figures, the action of the people, the moving away from the stiffness of the Gothic period and the Romanesque period that we've seen before, an introduction of human form, of human frailty, and of course introducing, in this case, dealing with the spiritual theme on this vegetable doors. So this is a major piece. This is a gilt bronze piece, fairly large piece, 21 inches by 17 inches, so pretty big piece of work done 1401, 1402, so right at the beginning of the Renaissance. One more piece, I got several pieces to show you from this period here, then we'll take a break. The Donatello David. David was a very popular theme, again, a significant spiritual figure, and, with the slaying of the giant and all of that. So the Donatello David, this is really one that's interesting because it's a little bit larger than a lifetime, showing a youth, almost like a young teenager here, but dressed in Renaissance clothes, not really dealing with, well, what few clothes he has on. But again, we have a combination of the male nude, derived from classical Greek and Rome, and the attire of the Renaissance, which is kind of an interesting combination.
Many people think that this is actually this figure was actually modeled by Leonardo da Vinci. That this might indeed be an example of what he looked like in his youth when he was really in training to be an artist. This is a major piece done in 1425, bronze, 62 inches high. So that's what, 5 feet something, 5 feet 2 inches, I think it's what it is. Okay, by the way, this was art, and changes were happening not only in art, but also in architecture. Let's look at the Pazzi Chapel. This is by Filippo Bernicelli, and others are involved in this, in 1430, 33 in Florence. Again, we see the influence of the Roman arch, so reminiscence of that, but changes that take place here. Also, this is combining. Notice up here we have the round part on top combined with this rectangular part on the bottom, which is kind of an interesting combination. Here we have kind of a colonnade going, taking place here with the looks like Ionic capitals on those. Excuse me. But again, this is an example of how the architecture is beginning to change. A lot of influence from Roman work. And then the back to a religious theme, the a piece by Conrad Wittes called The Miraculous Drought of Fishes. This is, again, a piece derived from a spiritual event, a Christian event, where I think this is supposed to be Jesus, if I remember correctly, commands these... commands the fishes basically to be caught, if I remember the story correctly, and really well depicted. Look at the perspective back in here, how they've dealt with both atmospheric perspective as well as linear perspective. See the buildings over here done a linear perspective, this one up in here, and of course foreshortening, showing the areas getting smaller and smaller with distance, the people getting smaller with distance. Very, very, very much done in taking advantage of these new technologies, and also the kind of people. We're seeing people in action, people that they would recognize in daily life in terms of the kinds of things that you're doing. Another piece, the San Francisco Facade by Leone Battista Alberti. This is another piece of architecture. Notice the changes that are taking place here. Up in this roof line, we have this portion that's giving these huge triangles up here, just as opposed to this round arch, straight line coming across, broken up into these columns that come across. So interesting combination of geometric shapes that take place in the front here. And then along the side, notice this colonnade again that takes place with the Roman arch, all through here, up and down we go, using the influences of the classical period, but with a new kind of twist to it. It's not just mirroring the classics, but it's reinterpreting the classics, letting it be an influence. Let's look at another piece. Of course, this one you've seen, The Birth of Venus by Botticelli. It's a beautiful piece, tempera on canvas, done in 1480. Again, it's a mythological theme with the wind god over here, the goddess of spring here, and Venus in the center. About to be draped with this cloth and the wind god blowing her into the shore here on afloat on her shell. The water, notice how the water is done very delicately out here and very calm out of here. We don't see a tumultuous wave series. We don't see any of that taking place. Okay, that's an important piece, by the way. Make sure you look at that piece. And last, then we're going to take a break. St. Francis in the Desert. This is St. Francis in Assisi. This is done by Giovanni Bellini. This is a very interesting piece because it shows, it's a calm, you know, most of these pieces are very calm and peaceful and clear. Notice how we see, you know, all the clear sky back here. We see a lot of perspective. They really were into perspective here, showing a lot of the foreshortening taking place in what's called deep space. As we look back, we see the scene going back for miles and miles and miles. And the figure is very small among all of this scene. A lot of detail, not as much as we're going to see until later on when the Renaissance begins to move to the north. So this is the St. Francis in the desert scene, and we're dealing with the beginning of the Renaissance, and we're going to come back and we're going to talk about the High Renaissance in Italy, 1500 to 1525. So don't go away. We'll be right back.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Las Palmas. It's a wonderful day, another point of pride for Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. As we open up our nursing skills lab, we take another step forward in making our university even greater. And now today, we're going to have our students right here in the state-of-the-art nursing lab. You know, as we celebrate the 50th anniversary, the creation of new facilities like the Nursing Skills Lab will improve the experience of our CSU Dominguez Hills students.
So we want this to be something, of course, for our students, for our faculty, for the university, but also the community. And that's something that we can go forward with and continue to develop those relationships.
First of all, I'd like to welcome and thank everyone for being here today to share with us this very exciting and important day of our Picture Art Foundation. We share the same planet, we share many common themes in our lives. Let us celebrate our similarities and respect our differences.
Skills represents such a wonderful establishment of cultures, culture, multiculturalism is our signature of our community.
My name is Shimada Miredo. I'm from Turkmenistan. I came to Cal State Dominguez Hills to study in sociology department. I really enjoy my life here. I like Dominguez Hills for its diverse population and professional approach of my instructors.
This is my nursing. Come on. Nice paper.
Sweet.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University Community Schools.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Renaissance. We're looking at art, and we're looking at the Renaissance. And I'm Bernard Baker, Professor of Art, California State University, Dominguez Art. Dominguez Art? Where's that? I never heard of that place. California State University, Dominguez Hills. But we're talking about art, so I am kind of on the right track here. Okay, we're going to deal with the High Renaissance. We've dealt with the beginning of the Renaissance, we've dealt with the early Renaissance, and we saw how the Renaissance kind of came out of this era in the Middle Ages of kind of an era of depression and limited knowledge, limited communication. It really evolved from the fact that all of Europe was kind of in a depressed state. And there was no communication to speak of between areas. Travel was limited. The countries were broken up into kingdoms. So there was no unification that really allowed people freedom to be able to grow and to be come up with ideas and have the freedom and the peace of mind to be able to think of other aspects and other goals besides survival. And the Renaissance allowed that. So, we're at the High Renaissance. What's the meaning of the High Renaissance? It's a short period, 25 years or so, but this is where some major artists emerged. And of course, you know these are icon names, household names, that everyone knows. Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo. These are two of the major figures that came out of the Renaissance. Everyone seems to know these names. But many other great artists emerged too, but these two are kind of highlighted in this section. And I want to show you a video about Leonardo da Vinci. Now, he's known as kind of the Renaissance man because he kind of epitomizes all the characteristics that we talked about in the beginning about the Renaissance. I mean, he was a painter, he was a sculptor, he was an architect, he was an inventor, he was an engineer, he was a botanist, he was a naturalist, he was a musician, he was a poet, on and on and on. This guy just covered the whole gamut of activities. I mean, what a mind, what a ability to span all of these areas and be good at all of them. I mean, that's the amazing thing. And so he was an incredible person and contributed a lot to not only the Renaissance, but to all of us even today. So let's take a look at this video about Leonardo da Vinci. It deals with the Last Supper and some other works. And if we see these works, I'm not going to show them to you in the videos, but we'll are in the stills when we come back. But I think it's interesting to see how he, kind of what his life was like. So let's listen to this piece.
Leonardo's story is the catalogue of unprecedented achievement, and yet also of incomplete and abandoned projects, no better symbolized than by the sorry state of his mural from a monastery in Milan, depicting the Last Supper of Christ. The art historian Kathleen Vial-Gaddis Brand sees Leonardo's frustrated ambition as part of a larger story.
Most of us have some sort of mental image of Leonardo's Last Supper. And if this is forced with some of the other famous artistic projects of the Renaissance, as we approach more closely, we discover that the actual work survives only in part. It's often difficult to reconstruct the artist's intention, to know what the work was to look like originally, to grasp something of the setting for which it was created. What remains to us of Leonardo's masterpiece is slowly being revealed to us by painstaking work of conservators. And the painting has suffered so much damage over the centuries that it is bound to remain a ghost of its former visual splendor, compelling, evocative, but also elusive. It makes a poignant visual metaphor for the fragmented image of the Renaissance that's come down to us, and it also serves to remind us of the insuperable practical difficulties that sometimes separated an high artistic imagination from its concrete physical realization in actual works of art. With the Last Supper, the problem was that Leonardo had the ambition of developing new methods for wall painting, and from a technical point of view that turned out to be catastrophic, and the painting began to decay as soon as it was finished. In other heroic enterprises, like Michelangelo's tomb for Pope Julius II or Bramante's designs for the new St. Peter's, the ambitious scale of the project itself doomed it eventually to incompletion, reduction, or transformation.
Yet if we look carefully at the fragmented remains of the Last Supper, we can still discern a complex work. The figure of Christ sits stable and calm at the center of the storm. The disciples surround him as though rolled back by a burst of energy, each reacting in a different way to the accusation, "One of you shall betray me." The disciples are young and old, beautiful and ugly. They give expression to their feelings, but they also express the idea of the first Christian Mass. A monk witnessed Leonardo at work in the monastery of Santa Maria della Grazia in Milan.
"Many a time I have seen Leonardo go early in the morning to work on the platform before the Last Supper, and there he would stay from sunrise till darkness, never laying down a brush, but continuing to paint without eating or drinking. Then 3 or 4 days would pass without his touching the work. Yet each day he would spend several hours examining it and criticizing the figures to himself."
There are very few works still existing which reveal what Leonardo did to transform 15th century painting, yet his influence on subsequent generations was enormous. One of his final paintings, The Virgin and St. Anne of 1507, reveals some of the qualities which made him so influential. St. Anne holds her virgin daughter Mary on her lap as the infant Christ reaches for the Lamb of God. Leonardo organized these figures into a pyramid of intertwined gazes, gestures, and forms. He veiled the figures and the landscape beyond them in a soft atmospheric haze. Muted colors glow out of darkness. The effect is lifelike, yet beyond life, an image of idealized beauty and transcendent love. In his few paintings, Leonardo created an ideal, but his inspiration was closely observed in nature. His almost numberless drawings reveal how he expanded the artist's role so it embraced philosophy and science. He described this lifetime project in the most ambitious terms.
"The deity in which invests the science of a painter functions in such a way that the mind of the painter is transformed into a copy of the divine mind. If the painter wishes to see beauty as that shown him, it lies in his power to create them. And if he wishes to see monstrosities that are frightful, ridiculous, or truly pitiable, he is Lord and God thereof."
There you see Leonardo da Vinci and his glorious work that he did. In fact, it's interesting that he had his faults. He was a great genius, but he was so involved with things that he would often not complete pieces, or like with the Last Supper, he was experimenting with paints, and it ended up being a big problem for the Last Supper, for the painting itself. And it was done in an area where there was a lot of moisture, and it just caused problems throughout all these years. I mean, we're lucky to have what we have of it.
In fact, we have some interesting comments here. Philip says, he says, I notice in the book that very few women artists exist. Were women not given the opportunity to become artists? I presume he means about the Renaissance. And that's very true. It's interesting because this is really a time when, obviously women have always been put behind men in virtually every profession. I mean, they had there was an attitude about where women fit, and that they weren't really given the opportunity to go beyond that. But that doesn't mean that women didn't have the ability and the passion for art and other endeavors as well, you know, music and poetry and all these things, but they were not allowed to present that and to really let it become known. But there was an artist, in fact, I was just looking when I read Philip's mention here, there was a young artist, artisanal, I can't think of her name, but there is a woman mentioned in our book. In the Renaissance, she was the daughter of a famous painter, and maybe someone can look that up and find it. I can't think of her last name, but I think her first name was Artemisia or something like that. Alexis says, why did Leonardo create the masterpiece of The Last Supper? If I remember correctly, I think that you might want to look this up and verify this, Alexis. That's a good question. But I think it's in a huge complex, which I think was a personal residence. And he was commissioned. If I remember, he would be invited to these residences of rich merchants or rulers, and be given projects that he would work on, and more than one. Like he'd be working on The Last Supper at the same time doing other things for this particular person. So he would have a number of projects, and he may be there for months or maybe even years in terms of living up to the needs of the patron. And if I remember correctly, I can't remember the ruler that he was involved in there for the Last Supper. In fact, it seems to me, as I remember now, I think that the ruler, some prince or someone, and I think he had him do the Last Supper as well as do studies for war machines or canals or something of that sort. But he was so talented, he involved himself in so many things. That was one of the great achievements that he contributed. I just wanted to show, in fact, let's look at his siege machine, which is a war machine that he came up with. And if you've seen some of the documentaries on him on television, you see some of these devices that he's done, which modern man have tried to put into real form to see if they actually would work. But here's one device he dealt with, which was kind of a protected cart-like device where people would stand in here and then they could go underneath here and be protected from arrows and oil, hot oil and things would come down on them. And they could, you know, come up, they could climb up here and then walk across over this wall and thereby, you know, go over this fortification. I want to show you one particular piece on the Mona Lisa, in fact. It was a famous piece. Everyone knows the Mona Lisa. I think if everyone had to name a piece of art, it would probably be the Mona Lisa. It seems to be, again, one of those household terms that everyone knows. And one of the things that the Mona Lisa exhibits, as well as other pieces, by the way, is a kind of smoky background. This is called sfumato, not a type of tomato. It's sfumato, which means smoke in Italy. So you know the one word now in Italy is sfumato. Not the best word to know, but it's an artwork. But it was a technique that he kind of developed. If you look at this piece, we look at it full screen here, I'll show you. You can see how the background is, you know, a little haze back in here, but back in the back is kind of a smoky, like, almost like a fog. Kind of course, in our area, we call it smog, but that's the sfumato effect on the Mona Lisa. It's also seen in the Madonna and Child with St. Anne. I think he actually mentions it in that particular piece, where he uses that same technique of sfumato. All right, we have another comment. Bertha says, who were the main artists during the Renaissance and how have they impacted our way of art today? Well, both, that's a great question. Of course, I mean, we all know Da Vinci, we all know Michelangelo, Bernini, Masaccio. I mean, they go on and on and on, but I think the two big ones that everyone knows is Da Vinci and Michelangelo. My son goes to a school called Da Vinci. I mean, look how common that is, right here in the L.A. area. So, you know, everyone knows. I don't know if he knows that he was an artist and what he did. But you ask the question, what did these artists contribute to us today? Many people have their attitude about art today. The people today, I remember my parents had this attitude about art. They didn't know where it came from. But it's based on the art of the Renaissance. So as common people, we look at the art of the Renaissance and see that as how art should be. It's realistic, it's humanistic, it depicts a story, it tells us something, it is done with clarity and yet with humanity. And it's done with excellence. The technique is like, we know it's done with by an artist. And I think those basic attributes for the common people, for us who are not, you know, trained artists, we can appreciate that kind of art. Also, you see it in the churches. You see it in particularly the churches and places of religious significance, where that kind of art is usually the type of art chosen to depict spiritual figures. Okay, Winnie says, I believe the female artist is Sofonisba and Aguisola. I don't know this person, Wendy. I really appreciate you giving me that, because I'm going to look her name up. Maybe you can find a piece of her work and let us know what she did. But that's not the name I was thinking of. But it indicates that women were beginning to emerge. That's what's important. Women are beginning to emerge, beginning to be recognized as competent artists, and being offered works to be done under the patronage of some of the same people who were patronizing the men artists. Alexis says, the Mona Lisa does not have eyebrows. Is that a unique piece of artwork? Well, that's interesting, because the Mona Lisa is actually a portrait of a real woman at the time. I forgot her name. It might tell us in the book. You might look that up, Alexis, and see. But the Mona Lisa is a name that's been kind of just tacked on. It wasn't really the person. I mean, it's not a person by the name of Mona Lisa. I think she was a daughter of some young rich or some rich person that had a portrait done. And Da Vinci just happened to paint this wonderful smile and this wonderful depiction of her, and it became known as the Mona Lisa. Why she doesn't have eyebrows? Maybe she plucked them. Does somebody pluck your eyebrows? Maybe I need to pluck mine. Anyway, the styles were different in that day, and it's like they are today. And people had different interpretations of how they wanted to look. She might have had some, I don't know, maybe she had some problem with her eyebrows as well. Who knows? But look into that. You might find something about her eyebrows. By the way, the interesting story about the Mona Lisa is that it was stolen. You know, it's in the Louvre in Paris, of course, and behind much security now. But at one time, it was not behind security. And some fellow, you might want to read about this, an Italian guy, came in and stole the painting. And he cut it out of the frame and walked out with it. So it has an interesting history. Okay, let's talk about the other famous artist, Michelangelo, who was a painter, sculptor, and architect. So he kind of confined himself to the arts, but a master, just a master of art. And in fact, they lived in the same era. One was older than the other. If I remember right, Michelangelo was younger than Da Vinci. So they were working in an overlap period of time, and they didn't really like each other very much. So there's a lot of controversy going on there. But let's look at this clip on Michelangelo, and you'll get an idea of some of the incredible work he did. It's titled Monumental Figures by Michelangelo.
Thank you.
portrait of the artist as a young man. Not literally a portrait, but certainly one in spirit. Michelangelo was 27 when he started to carve the figure of David for his home city of Florence. He portrayed the supreme confidence of a young conqueror, and yet in the same moment he revealed self-doubt, perhaps the self-doubt of an artist with heroic ambition. If Leonardo was ahead of his times, Michelangelo was supremely a man of his times. From the very beginning, he found himself at the center of power and influence.
The project to create a colossus of marble had been underway since the early 15th century, and the block from which Michelangelo's David was quarried was brought down from Carrara in the 1460s. Several attempts were made to have the block carved, but they all came to naught. It was, in fact, the first monumental freestanding male nude carved in marble since antiquity. Michelangelo himself is a David who confronts the gigantic challenge of the marble that no one has been able successfully to carve. Originally, Michelangelo's David was to have been placed on a buttress of Florence Cathedral, but by the time the David was completed, it was clear to everyone at once that this was a miracle of art, as it was called in its own time, a kind of achievement that should be integrated in the Florentine body politic in its broadest sense. Now, David is the young biblical hero who, against all the odds, manages to overcome the armed giant Goliath. So David is the metaphor for the miraculous victory of right over might. So it's no surprise to us that Florence should, throughout its history, have seen itself as a David among the city-states, maintained against its powerful enemies because of its righteousness.
In 1873, the Florentine city fathers decided to bring Michelangelo's David indoors from the Piazza della Signoria here to this museum, the Accademia. Later, a copy was put up on the site, but Michelangelo's sculpture itself here was deprived of its original role as a civic guardian and was redefined more narrowly, more extensively, as a work of art. Other sculptures by Michelangelo were also gathered here as if to bring together a sort of secular shrine to the great Florentine. But this historical happenstance gives us the opportunity to look at Michelangelo from a different perspective, to look at his unfinished works, sculptures that he was forced to abandon for a variety of reasons entirely beyond his control. Michelangelo had a very unusual way of approaching the block of marble when it came from the quarry. This is the skin of the stone as it's been prepared for by the quarry master, and Michelangelo began cutting from the front face only, moving in layer by layer into the stone as though he were carving a relief. For, as his contemporary says, it's as though a wax model were being lifted out of a bath of water. Obviously, the forms that are closest to us emerge first from the model. This technical system had two advantages. First, it meant that Michelangelo could organize the composition of his figure of the pose on one plane as though it were a picture, and keep visual control of it as he carved inward through the block. It also meant that the process of design, the creative process of changing his mind, could continue while he was actually carrying out the statue, working it in the stone.
Michelangelo abandoned the Matthew sculpture in 1505 when he was summoned to Rome by the new Pope, Julius II. Pope Julius demanded a tomb which would match the majesty of his self-image. Michelangelo's original design was for a freestanding pyramid of marble with tier upon tier of life-size figures, so ambitious a design that many artists would have had to work for many years to make it real. Only one figure on the final tomb, completed 30 frustrating years later, carries the force of the original idea, the figure of Moses.
The song he calls Michelangelo Terribile speaks often of his terribilità, which is a word that really has no precise equivalent in English, but it was talking about, I suppose, a kind of awe-inspiring power of temperament. And the same word, terribilità, was also used to describe Pope Julius II. There is no doubt that artist and Pope met their match in each other. And it's always been felt, there's a kind of undercurrent of feeling that although the Moses is in no sense a portrait of Julius II, that it is an evocation precisely of the terribilità that artist and Pope share.
Okay, we got a good view of some of the classic pieces that Leonardo or Michelangelo did. He's really, you know, I have a kind of favoritism toward his work. I guess because I really love his classical influence, the way he reinterprets the classical look, this magnificent feeling that he expresses through his work. But what a great artist! Let's look at a couple of pieces of his. The Sistine Ceiling, of course, a painting done 1473 to 80, done in the Vatican. I don't know if some of you might have had a chance to see this. I was to Rome. I didn't get a chance to see that. I'm going to make a trip back just to see that. But it was all foggy, or not foggy, but dark and actually dirty. They didn't know that until they cleaned it. And then it found this pristine color. And it's really a beautiful, beautiful piece. But done again with this mixture of classical influence with Christian themes throughout the piece, and done with these almost like a comic book with different panels depicting all of these pieces. And one of my favorite pieces, of course, is the Pieta. I just love this piece. It's incredible that he can carve this wonderful, wonderful piece. Look at the feeling in this piece, though. Just put that up full screen, if you would. Just look at this. I mean, this tremendous expression on Jesus' mother's face here, and the body, what he's done with the body to make it so fluid and like it's real. It's just amazing. The drapery, again, look how deep the folds are on the drapery. How he's carved that so incredibly beautiful. So that to me is a favorite piece. Of course, classical piece to David. I mean, how can anyone not think of Michelangelo without considering the David? It's a beautiful piece. I showed two views of it here to show the strength of this piece. But look how he kind of exaggerated things, which gives it more power. You look at this; it's a young man, supposedly a boy. But look how big he made the hands, almost like a mature, almost like a fighter. You see a good view of the hand on this side here. How he twisted this hand and the muscles. Very much like the Greek interpretation that we've seen, contrapposto taking place here with the curve of the body. So we see this reinterpretation of the classical work of Michelangelo and the David. It's just a beautiful piece. A piece of architecture that he did, the St. Peter's Basilica, an aerial view of this piece. You know, this is built on the site of the St. Peter's Basilica that we saw that was patterned after the Roman piece, but which was, of course, just a rectangular structure like this originally. But that was demolished, and in its place has made this beautiful, intricate design here in the form, again, of a Latin cross, and with this dome on top and the great audience area out here. The Pope, of course, stands on the back and announces his
makes his announcements out to the public in there. But this is based on the floor plan. Let's take a look at the floor plan of St. Peter's, one of the original floor plans. You can see how the cross is made up into this configuration of the outline here, this wonderful decorative outline. It's a reinterpretation of that basilica form that emerged into the ground plan that we saw in the Gothic works, and then on from that to this particular piece. So, tremendous work by Michelangelo. So, as we come out of the Renaissance, we see now that we're moving into, at least in Italy, we see how we're going up into the northern area. Oh, by the way, there's a couple of questions here I wanted to respond to. By the way, I wanted to show you something else, too, that I looked at while you were looking at the film. Maria says, is it possible that the smoky background in the Mona Lisa was to show some form of depression the artist had, which would be Da Vinci, of course, or a form of emotional distress? You know, I haven't heard anything about that, Maria. It's an interesting observation and interpretation on your part, which, of course, is where new ideas come from. So you might do a little research on that and see. But I did happen to look. Mona Lisa is on page 20 of our book, and someone asked about the Mona Lisa a little earlier, and I mentioned that that's not really the name of the person in there. It says here that it was painted by Leonardo da Vinci during the early years of the 16th century. The center was probably named the person, a woman named Lisa Gherardini del Giocondo. I'm not sure how it's pronounced. So it's a woman. Leonardo portrayed her seated on a balcony that overlooks a landscape of rock and water. Her left forearm rests on her arm of her chair. Her right hand settled gently over her left wrist. She turns her head to look at us with a hint of a smile. So that's the interpretation. So it really is a woman. This is an ordinary, you know, probably noble woman or some rich person. And shows how these paintings take on kind of an identity of their own. I wanted to show you, if I can show what's on the computer here. Someone asked about women in the Renaissance, and I did a quick search about women in the Renaissance, and look, I have a whole number of them. This is the late Renaissance. This is Lovina Terlink, a Flemish painter. We're going to talk about the Flemish people in just a little bit. She was active in the late 1500s, so she's in the late Renaissance. This is Katharina van Hemelsen, another Flemish painter, also active in the middle of the 1500s. Here's one that someone mentioned this one. Sofonisba Agisola, an Italian painter, again, she lived quite a while here. She's 90 years old when she died. She went through the 1500s up to the early 1600s. So she transcended over into the Baroque period. La Fina Fontana, this Italian painter. Fede Galicia. This is another Italian painter, late 1800s. Here she is. Artemisia Ginoleschi. This is the one I was thinking of. I think her work is in our book, if I remember right. She's actually the daughter of an artist, Orazio Ginoleschia. He was a recognized. So here's an interesting, I don't know, there's a movie about her. If you look up the movie, you'll see a movie about her. I remember seeing that movie sometime. So there's some examples of women artists. There's some more in there, too. Maria says, was Michelangelo's David to show common man or the perfection of common man? Good question, Maria. Actually, Michelangelo's David is to show, if you read about that, it's really showing it, the perfection of man as this biblical character, the strength, the confidence. If you look at that figure, confident figure, he's sure of himself, he's strong, he's vigorous, He has all these attributes that all of us try to obtain toward. Okay, let me ask you one more question. We have just a few minutes to get into this last section here. I wanted to just talk a little bit about the Renaissance in the North, which is, of course, areas of Switzerland, Germany, northern France, and the Netherlands, and it's influenced by the late Middle Ages. And I want to show you a piece of artwork and ask you, what is the relevance? This is a question of the day for you here, another one. What is the relevance of the diagonal shape in this artwork? And this is a piece of artwork. I'm going to tell you the name. See if you can tell me the name of this piece. You see this piece behind me? Let me show you full screen what I'm talking about. So this piece has two figures here, of course. A lot of stuff on the shelf back here. But look at this strange thing right here, this diagonal down here. What's that doing in there? Is that a mistake or what? Tell me what that's all about. Okay, let's talk about the Renaissance in the North. By the way, you can call in 1-800-339-1193 or text in and tell me about this piece. You might also tell me what the name of this piece is and who the artist is. This might come up a little later on, so I want to see if you know what it is. Okay, the characteristics of this particular piece. By the way, let's show a map. Let me show you what we're talking about. We're talking about the Netherlands here. And I'm going to show you a couple of pieces, and we only have a couple of minutes here. Let me show, if I can show you a map. Okay, we're talking about this area up in here. Well, I got a little too low there. Up in here, the Netherlands, France, but primarily in the Netherlands. And the reason that was a rich area is because there was a lot of transportation out of here, getting materials, goods out, around, down to other areas. So those people made a lot of money so they could afford to have be a patron of the arts. But the characteristics of this period, this is important. Fondness for detail and decoration. A preoccupation for decoration and the surface, decoration of surfaces and things within the composition. Subject matter was precisely realistic. Composition often symmetrical and more active than Italian work. That's kind of a general statement. Use of more symbolism, a lot of symbolism in this work. The North really likes symbolism. Use of more rich colors and biblical themes in individual portraiture and genre. You hardly see any mythology at all. And use of sometimes grim and gory kind of subject matter. Let's look at a couple of pieces. The Royal Altarpiece by Robert Chopin. This is a piece that shows the altarpiece, which is a triptych. It's three panels, and here we have a story. I think we saw this piece before. The religious aspect going on. People at the door out here. Someone inside working in a workshop. So a triptych of that sort. A lot of detail, a lot of story. Let's look at the Insenheim. Oh, that was the Insenheim. This is the Insenheim altarpiece. Again, we have the crucifixion in the center. We have a figure over here, looks like partial clothes. I'm not sure what that is. And another figure on this side. Oh, the one I wanted to show you. Pop that up while we're going out. This is the ambassador piece. That ambassador piece is a great piece. You want to know that piece, so look at that piece in our book. You'll see what that figure is. I'll give you a hint. It's a skull. Why is it there? Okay, everyone. We'll see you next week. Keep looking at art.